Today I wanted to talk about the first fleet. So that is the second fleet. Hello guys and welcome back to my channel. Today's video is going to be a bit of a history video. I wanted to talk a bit about the second fleet. So the second fleet are the second contingent of convict ships that were sent to Australia from Britain. They're often overshadowed by the first fleet, who are of course the famous ones that landed in 1788 with Arthur Phillip. This second fleet arrived in June 1790, so this month, June, is the 231st anniversary of the arrival of the second fleet. Before I get started, please go ahead and hit the subscribe button and ring the notification bell because it really helps out my channel when you do. And now let's get to chatting. This story is a little bit of a sad one. It's pretty dark. I can see why it's often kind of pushed aside for the more glorious story of the First Fleet. But I still think it's really important to learn about and to remember. Perhaps you even had ancestors who arrived on the Second Fleet. So the British justice system of the 18th century, we all know, was pretty harsh, and a lot of crimes were punishable by the death sentence. So the introduction of transportation as a punishment gave judges another kind of option with their sentencing. Initially, of course, convicts were sent to the Americas, but after the Revolutionary War, the British prisons started overcrowding once again once they couldn't send anyone to America, so they had to decide where they were going to send them. And of course, the newly discovered Australia became the place to set up a new colony. So the first fleet sailed in 1788. There were 11 ships that were part of it. They did a lot of planning and preparation before that sort of event because it was the first one. So it ran fairly smoothly. The convicts were allowed up on deck to, you know, get fresh air and sunlight every day generally. And they got access to fresh food after stop-offs. So overall, the first fleet had a fairly low death rate. It was pretty smooth. The second fleet, however, was a disaster. You might have heard of it referred to as the Death Fleet, as it became later known. So the second fleet consisted of 6 ships. There was the Lady Juliana, Guardian, Justinian, Surprize, Neptune and Scarborough. These carried a total of 1,038 convicts, of whom 273, that's 26% of them, perished on the voyage. Also, about half of them landed quite ill. So what went wrong? What was the difference? So as I mentioned with the first fleet, there was a lot of preparation that went into it because it was the first fleet. And after that one, the second fleet, the British government decided to outsource. So the British government contracted a company called Camden, Calvert and King, and they were formerly slave traders. So they previously transported slaves to the North Americas. In this instance, they were paid per head of convict that they transported. So the issue was that the government didn't stipulate that the convicts had to arrive healthy or even alive. So the conditions on these ships were cramped. They filled as many as they possibly could. They didn't let them up on the decks. They kept them chained below the decks. They didn't have access to sunlight. They were starved. The conditions were absolutely abysmal. So William Hill, the second captain of the New South Wales Corps and commander of the detachment on the transport Surprise, which brought convicts to New South Wales with the Second Fleet, described the ordeal. The bark I was on board of was indeed unfit from her make and size to be sent to so great a distance. If it blew but a trifling gale, she was lost in the waters, of which she shipped so much that from the Cape, the unhappy wretches, the convicts, were considerably above their waists in water, and the men of my company, whose berths were not so far forward, were nearly up to their middles. In this situation, they were obliged, for the safety of the ship, to be penned down. But when the gales abated, no means were used to purify the air by fumigations, no vinegar was applied to rectify the nauseous steams issuing from their miserable dungeons. Humanity shudders to think that of 900 male convicts embarked in this fleet, 370 are already dead,
and 450 are landed sick and so emaciated and helpless that very few or any of them can be saved by care or medicine, so that sooner it pleases God to remove them, the better it will be for this colony, which is not in a situation to bear any burden, as I imagine the medicine chest to be nearly exhausted and provisions a scarce article. We also have word from Joseph Smith, who was a convict who arrived on the Second Fleet. So in an interview, he recalled, "The days, weeks and months, most of the time chained up below deck, a few dim lamps burning less than half the day, the clink and rattle of irons as the ship pitched and tossed, salt water washing down the hatches, and the stench. We never quite got used to the stench. Then there was the coughing and wheezing, the sores, the pus, the blood, and the dying and the fear. But most of all, more than anything else, there was the hunger." Joseph also described carrying the sick convicts up to the decks when they landed in Sydney and the totally unceremonious disposal of their bodies into pits. He also had his fears confirmed that they'd been starved. He felt like their rations were quite short, and that turned out to be true. So the contracted company, Camden, Calvert and King, had been told that any of the remaining supplies that they had on their ship, they could sell once they landed in Sydney, and they could sell it at a huge markup. So it was in their interest to hold as much of that food as possible and then to sell it at Sydney for a huge profit. So we also have a word from the Reverend Richard Johnson, who was the First Fleet's chaplain. He left an eyewitness account of the landing of the convicts in June 1790 at the colony's wharf. "I beheld a sight truly shocking to the feelings of humanity, a great number of them laying, some half, others nearly quite naked, without either bed or bedding, unable to turn or help themselves. Spoke to them as I passed along, but the smell was so offensive that I could scarcely bear it. The landing of these people was truly affecting and shocking. Great numbers were not able to walk, nor to move hand or foot. Such were slung over the side of the ship in the same manner as they would a cask, a box, or anything of that nature. Upon their being brought up to the open air, some fainted, some died upon deck, and others in the boat before they reached the shore. When come on shore, many were not able to walk, to stand, to stir themselves in the least. Hence, some were led by others, some creeped upon their hands and knees, and some were carried upon the backs of others." Also, one of the convicts from the Lady Juliana had a letter printed in the Morning Chronicle where she described the arrival of the Neptune and the Scarborough and the Surprize. "Oh, if you had but seen the shocking sight of the poor creatures that came out in the three ships, it would make your heart bleed. They were almost dead. Very few could stand, and they were obliged to fling them as you would goods and hoist them out of the ships, they were so feeble. And they died 10 or 12 a day when they first landed. But some of them are getting better. They were not so long as we were in coming here, but they were confined and had bad victuals and stinking water. The governor was very angry and scolded the captains a great deal, and I heard intended to write to London about it, for I heard him say it was murdering them. It, to be sure, was a melancholy sight. What a difference between us and them." So Governors Hunter and Philip both expressed their concerns about the treatment of the convicts aboard the Second Fleet. And Governor Philip did actually write back to England complaining about the state of the convicts when they arrived. He was particularly bothered that the convicts were not allowed to move about and exercise while they were on the ship, which led to their particularly emaciated conditions. And he went on to point out the harsh but practical truth that men in this condition were incapable of labor. He ultimately, in the new colony, they wanted laborers, people who could work. They didn't want sick people who were laying around taking up the rations. In the longer term, the conditions aboard the convict vessels did improve. That happened slowly and through a whole series of reforms. I can talk about that in more videos if you're interested, but I think I'll wrap this one up for now. I know it's a really sad story, but I feel like it's one that often gets overlooked in the history lessons, and I think, you know, being June again, the anniversary of the arrival of the Second Fleet, I just think that we should think about those 1,038 convicts who were put in those awful ships and who had to endure such horrific conditions. So So did you descend from one of the second fleeters? If so, please let me know in the comment section below. I'd love to hear their story. And I hope you enjoyed this video, and thank you so much for hanging out with me today. I will see you soon in my next video. Bye guys.